Ahead on NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
We'll talk with a new head of the EPA and hear how he plans to work with cattle producers. Plus, see how an award-winning cow-calf operation is caring for its animals.
And now, NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen with host Kevin Ochsner.
Hello and welcome to NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen. I'm Kevin Ochsner. Thank you for joining us. From policy issues to regulatory overreach, there are plenty of decisions that come out of Washington, D.C. that can keep us cattle producers up at night. And that doesn't even include the worries we have about things happening in our own backyards. At the recent NCBA Legislative Conference in Washington, D.C., we asked cattlemen and women to share their biggest request or concern for the Trump administration.
If there's one thing that I would ask of our new administration, it would be that we work on trade and that we particularly work very diligently in trying to get U.S. beef into the country of China.
Number one on our list are the market issues and international trade. Trade is so vitally important to our industry.
I would say the importance of trade. Right now, it impacts not only our producers at the state who are selling calves to go to the feedlot and be finished. I mean, we have to have trade, but plain and simple. We've got to be able to sell our product to outside of the United States, and there's really some great opportunities out there.
The biggest issue that I see facing the cattle industry is overregulation. The fact that the agencies have, in effect, legislated themselves into positions of power, and unless we pull that back and make a level playing field, it's going to be very difficult for the producer, be it a cow-calf operator, a stocker, or a feeder, to be able to operate on an efficient basis.
As a beef producer, I just ask that they really get to know agriculture prior to making a decision. They use the resources, the people that are on the ground doing the work, so that they understand it. So many times decisions are made arbitrarily, and if you're not in the trenches, if you're not doing the job, you don't understand the full effect and the scope of that and what it can do to an entire industry.
The biggest ask I have of this administration for my operation, my family operation, is to engage us early and often in all decisions. I don't care if they're public land grazing related, if they're water related, if they're endangered species related. You need to engage us early and often. We have some solutions. They will work. They are cost effective, but we are a partner in all of this for this country, and you need to treat us like a partner, and we need to get back to that framework.
As a beef producer in the state of Missouri, my biggest request for the Trump administration is to roll back regulation, whether that be from the EPA, whether that be from the Department of the Treasury Department on taxes. We need regulation relief.
As you heard, overregulation is top of mind with many in the cattle business. And the cattle industry's relationship with the Environmental Protection Agency has often been challenging due to burdensome regulations that can have a negative impact on farmers and ranchers. But as Cattlemen to Cattlemen reporter Russell Nemitz tells us, there may be some good news on the horizon thanks to the change in leadership at the EPA.
You take care of the land that you farm and you ranch. Why do you do that? Because you know it matters to yield in the future. And there needs to be a trust by those in Washington, D.C. that you care about that, that we partner together.
With those words, the new Environmental Protection Agency Administrator Scott Pruitt signaled that change is coming and the cattle industry may finally get some relief from overregulation. He was speaking to cattlemen and women at NCBA's annual legislative conference in Washington, D.C. Pruitt says he's working to build a partnership between the agency and the men and women who serve as stewards of our natural resources.
I think as we go forward, making sure that we're partnering together and hearing the voice of farmers and ranchers and those in agriculture across the country is very, very important, because I think up until the last few years, that was a common practice, and of late it's not been. And so we don't start from a premise that we know best. We start from a premise that we've got partners at the local level that care about the same things that we care about, and we need to respect that and work with those folks.
And we really look forward to working with Mr. Pruitt throughout his tenure here at EPA and work to help cattlemen and farmers across this nation as it pertains to the rulemaking on all the many things that EPA regulates. It gives us a lot of opportunity to work together to have rules that protect the environment and also don't harm farmers and ranchers unnecessarily.
The Pruitt appointment is just one sign that things may improve for the beef industry under the new administration. President Trump also recently signed an executive order that begins the process to roll back the controversial Waters of the U.S. rule.
I think many of the instances we've seen over the last few years of this agency overreaching and having regulatory uncertainty as a result of not following the statutory framework is something that we're going to fix. We saw that particularly with the Waters of the United States rule, the Waters rule, and as your members indicated, that was something that needed to be addressed and fixed. The president took action on February 28th to do that with the executive order, and then we followed shortly thereafter to do away with that rule and make sure that it's done right going forward.
Very excited about Administrator Pruitt. I like his track record in Oklahoma of challenging the EPA when they overstepped their bounds. And I think someone with that background is going to come in and take a real business-like look, a real common sense look at what regulations we need. We all want to protect our environment. Cattlemen and cattlewomen are the original environmentalists. So we're all on board on that, but we were not on board with overburdensome regulations we've dealt with in the last administration.
Pruitt recognizes that the relationship between the EPA and the beef industry has been rough over the past several years. It's something he's resolved to fix.
I think what's happened over the last several years is a competition, kind of an adversarial relationship, where this agency was seen as being a regulator that was trying to stop production and stop the ability to feed, you know, this country and feed the world, actually. And that's not the approach we start from. We recognize that it's good to produce, it's good to grow, it's good to harvest the natural resources that God has provided us with, but to do so with a sensitivity to the environment.
We want clean water, we want clean air, and so it's important to strive to get those things, but at the same time, let's use common sense on rulemaking to where we don't get unnecessarily burdened by over-regulatory rules that don't really help protect the environment, but harm us greatly.
At the end of the day, land use decisions, private property owners, and those locally ought to be making decisions on how best to use their land. And we ought to be partnering with them as they do that, not dictating to them how they should use it.
Reporting from Washington, D.C., I'm Russell Nimitz for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
If you'd like to support the beef industry, why not become an NCBA member? By doing so, you'll be sustaining the work of NCBA in defending and advocating for cattle-producing families just like yours in Washington, D.C. There's strength in numbers, so to join up, just call toll-free 1-866-USA-BEEF or visit the website beefusa.org. Up next on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, we'll show you a family operation that takes great pride in raising safe, quality, and wholesome beef for consumers. Plus, learn how you can become BQA certified without even leaving your home. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
There is a new world out there, revealing itself in unpredictable ways. A world that demands more from the land and those who grow, farm, and build on it. This new world calls for the ingenuity to get more out of it while preserving as much as we can. After all, to stay ahead of tomorrow, we need to be equipped for it today. New Holland, equipped for a new world.
Tough Fence will last three times longer and is four times stronger than low tensile fencing. High tensile wire, solid vertical stays, and tight fixed knots all provide superior strength. You will use fewer posts, saving time, labor, and money. Protect your investment for generations with Stay Tough Fence. Stay strong, stay tight, stay tough.
Welcome back. Each year, several businesses and individuals are honored for their commitment to the principles of the Beef Quality Assurance Program. These winners strive to provide consumers with confidence that they're buying a safe, wholesome product when they choose beef. Let's take a look at this year's winner of the Cow-Calf Award.
The Wolf family has been raising and selling cattle for more than five decades. Although Wolf Cattle is well known for its limousine seed stock, the company operates in multiple sectors of the cattle industry.
We're a cow-calf operation that's based in three states. We headquarter out of Morse, Minnesota. We have six feed yards, three in South Dakota, two in Nebraska, and one in Minnesota. And then we have three ranches, two stocker ranches in South Dakota and a cow-calf ranch in Nebraska. Sandy Ridge Ranch is where we're at today.
The focus at Wolf Cattle has always been on raising the best quality genetics with animal welfare and consumer confidence at the center of their decision-making process. They believe animal care is directly connected to the attitude and knowledge of their employees, which is why Wolf Cattle requires all members of their staff to get their beef quality assurance certification.
So everybody here at Sandy Ridge Ranch is certified through the Beef Quality Assurance Program. Along with that, all the cattle haulers that we work with, all the ranchers that we work with, neighbors, we try to get them, you know, on the same certification programs.
I think that a lot of consumers are unsure of how animals are being raised and entering into the food supply. And programs like BQA are super important to make sure that farmers do have standards, and we're all working together as a team to create really wholesome food for the American consumer and beyond.
We have over 80 employees in the beef segment of our company in Wolf Cattle, and we're proud that all of those employees have went through the BQA certification process. I've been trained, and even when I'm not here on site, I can be comfortable that things are getting done right.
Because of this strong commitment to animal care, Wolf Cattle has developed a program called Be Kind, which gives employees additional training on proper cattle handling methods.
When the new employees are hired, we make sure that on the first day they get their Be Kind training, and that goes over kind of any time a human and animal would interact, and make sure that the employee understands we have a zero tolerance for any animal mistreatment, and they will be terminated if they were to mistreat an animal at any time.
We have a zero tolerance on any animal mistreatment, and that ranges, you know, within Wolf Cattle, and then also, you know, everybody along the chain there, ranchers we work with, cattle haulers we work with, packers we work with. We make sure that everybody is well aware of our initiatives that we have.
Safety is another priority. They created the Be Safe initiative to teach the proper procedures for dealing with cattle, which protects both employees and animals.
It's important to us because we want each employee to return to their families safe at night, every night. We require all of our employees to wear a safety vest and then to have safety glasses on hand at all times.
Not only do you see the safety vest worn on our employees throughout the company, we have all our employees wired up to look for danger points, and if they see something, communicate that. All of our team meetings are started with a safety discussion, and we want everyone to continue to think about being safe.
At Wolf Cattle, they have an open gate policy and encourage visitors to stop in at any time to learn more about the ranch.
That's part of one of our core values, keeping our sites tour ready. That helps both us staying safer around the cattle, working in a clean environment, and it works the cattle. It helps the cattle as well, keeps them healthy, and helps in the well-being of the animal.
Wolf Cattle has a policy of, you know, all are welcome. We want to show people around. We want to show people what we're doing. There's a lot of people, consumers, that includes kids, that do not necessarily understand where their food is produced. And we want to be part of that solution that shows them how that works.
The team at Wolf Cattle is proud of the accomplishments they've achieved and feel it's a direct result of consistent quality training, which is why the BQA guidelines will always be at the heart of everything they do.
I am a believer in the BQA program because it has helped our ranch in really take it to the next level and help us start understanding the importance of animal handling and of continuing our record keeping and continuing to take care of that animal.
It's great where we're at now, but I believe we're looking in the right direction. There's improving in the right places, so I foresee a great future.
There's no one silver bullet that gets us there. It's just a lot of little details, in which a big part of that is BQA and BQA training and making sure things is ever done right in every way.
And joining us now with more on the BQA program is Jesse Fulton, Associate Director of Producer Education for NCBA. Jesse, let's get started by talking about the overall importance of the Beef Quality Assurance Program.
So the Beef Quality Assurance Program is important not only to the producer because it can help them improve their bottom line by implementing the latest in cattle production practices, but it's also important to the ever-evolving beef consumer who still have concerns about how cattle are being raised. Through Beef Quality Assurance, this assures the consumer that cattle producers today are raising cattle in a safe, healthy, and wholesome manner.
Very good. And I know you've been working hard on developing a new set of materials that are actually electronically delivered. Can you tell us more about that?
Right. So our old BQA modules that were online were filled with a lot of video and were not as engaging to participants. Mm-hmm. So now we went through those online modules, we revamped them and updated the material, and then we made it so that they're more engaging in hopes that participants that do them online get more out of the program.
And so how are you currently using those online modules?
So those online modules can be found at bqa.org and by clicking on Get Certified Today, and they will be prompted on screen to go through, get registered, and they can take a course, begin courses in either cow-calf, stocker, or feed yard.
So for our viewers who may be interested in becoming BQA certified, how do they do it and what's the cost?
Getting BQA certified is very easy. First, we always strongly recommend that they get certified through an online or on-hand session. Mm-hmm. They can do this by contacting their state coordinators, which can be found at bqa.org, mm-hmm. by checking the state requirements. And then we know that beef cattle producers live very busy lives, and if they cannot attend one of these events, they can do the online modules, and that is free 24/7.
That's totally free. Outstanding. So there are several great options. So beyond beef quality assurance training, I know the producer education team works on a number of other activities. Tell us a little bit about some of those, Jesse.
Right. So right now, we're finishing up the 2016 National Beef Quality Audit, and those results and findings will be rolled out at the 2017 Cattle Industry Business Meeting in the summer. Mm-hmm. We're also working on our Cattle Transportation Quality Assurance modules, and those modules are for cattle haulers across the U.S. to become certified through BQA practices and principles. And finally, we're about to roll out our Stockmanship Stewardship Program. And that program, it will teach producers low-stress cattle handling techniques, and they can also become BQA certified on-site at those regional events.
Fantastic. You've got a full plate, it sounds like.
We sure do. We're working hard over there.
Thank you so much for coming today.
Thank you.
As Jesse mentioned, you can use the all-new interactive online classroom to begin your training to earn BQA certification. Visit bqa.org for all the details. Still to come on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, we'll show you how NCBA is working to educate nutritionists on the health benefits of eating beef. And later, learn about a study that's working to expand what we know about feed efficiency. Stay with us. We'll be right back.
Saddle up and make your way to Denver, Colorado for the 2017 Cattle Industry Summer Business Meeting. This is your chance to stay up to date on beef industry trends and policies, meet with industry leadership and your fellow cattlemen and women. Plus, you'll get insights on hot topics at the Issues Forums. Mark your calendar for the 2017 Cattle Industry Summer Business Meeting, July 12th to the 15th in Denver. Find out more at beefusa.org.
What does it mean to be dependable? It means you do what you say you'll do time and time again. Because performance isn't optional, and your task is essential. For over 95 years, we have proven ourselves to be the most dependable choice. That's why the cattlemen of this great nation trust Ritchie to provide fresh water on demand. Ritchie, proud to be a partner to the American cattlemen since 1921.
Out here, we're hostile, cold, and cruel. a way of life. There's no better way to live. Guts. Glory. Ram.
Welcome back. Cattle producers are always on the lookout for allies outside the industry who can share with consumers the health benefits of beef. Brad Bulla has more on an important Beef Checkoff funded event aimed at reaching nutritionists and other health influencers to help share the positive story of beef.
At first glance, it may look like just another meeting, but this is Live Well 2016. An event funded by the Beef Checkoff and attended by an elite group of health professionals and nutrition communicators. The Live Well participants heard from leading experts on topics ranging from the value of beef in the diet to understanding beef cuts and how cattle are raised.
One thing that I learned about beef this week that was really surprising to me was the different cuts of meat and how you can use them in a lot of different culinary applications. And I think that consumers need to hear a little bit more about those lean options and the ways that they can prepare them in their homes.
Whether in the kitchen, at a restaurant, or during a presentation, the event gave participants focused time to engage in discussions about beef nutrition, food preparation, and beef production.
As I look back over my career the last 20 years, I think, and you consider the retail meat case and how it's changed over the last, say, two decades, the consumer is ever more confused by all the variety of offerings in the retail meat case. And so anytime we get the opportunity as faculty from the Institute or as advocates for the industry to share the production side of the industry with groups like this group of bloggers and registered dietitians, we feel like that's time and effort well spent.
I believe it's important for dietitians to be able to share this message that we've learned at Live Well about how farmers and ranchers really do care for their animals. So it's important for us to really expand what the real knowledge and science is behind beef and around protein and the needs that Americans have, and better help them apply that to their daily practice.
I'm Brad Buller reporting for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
Joining us now is Shelley Johnson. She's in charge of nutrition outreach for NCBA. Shelley, we just saw some great coverage from the Live Well event, and I'm curious, who are the people who attend, and more importantly, why is it important that we reach out to those folks?
So we brought together a mixture of registered dietitians, mainly media dietitians, supermarket dietitians, and food and parenting bloggers. This is a really important mix of communicators because these are the folks that consumers trust. They also have a broad reach. So we consider them message multipliers, meaning when we give them beef nutrition information that inspires them or is consistent with the kind of information they share, they share it out. And it's really well received because they are a trusted resource for consumers.
And what kind of tangible results have you seen from this recent Live Well event?
So that's my favorite thing. When I get back to my office after going to one of these events is watching to see how they use the information that was shared. We bring them together at the end of every Live Well event to ask them, like, what was the most powerful thing you learned, or how do you think you'll share this information? And the kind of collaboration that comes out of that is really exciting for me to see as a program manager. I think one of the most powerful ahas I had was when we shared information about beef as a first food for babies. That's actually Checkoff funded research. We shared it with them. And a retail dietitian that attended the event, she went back to her corporate retail dietitian team and said, we got to do something with this. And they're going to be launching a campaign in store. And this is for a large regional retailer that's going to be doing this later this summer. So I'm pretty stoked to see how that shapes up.
That's outstanding. Now tell me this. I know this event is important, but you do a lot of other things to reach out to nutritionists and let them know the health and nutrition benefits of beef. Tell us more about that.
Sure. So we reach dietitians on a regular basis. We know they're really important. But we also know that physicians are really important too. They don't have a lot of time to spend talking about food or nutrition with their patients, but we know they're answering questions, and we know they're sharing information about diet. We know that cardiologists are typically telling people how to shape their diet to improve heart health, and sometimes beef comes into that conversation. And we also realize that the amount of training that medical doctors get on nutrition is pretty limited in their training. So we're looking at one-on-one ways or broader ways to reach this group. I have a really great story to tell about a doctor that we engaged with last year. We shared with him the bold research that I know you and I have talked about before.
Yes.
And he was really wowed by it. Like, he didn't realize beef's role in heart healthy eating pattern. And he wrote a story in U.S. News and World Report.
Wow.
Yeah, so we were really excited to see that. The Checkoff also sponsors key conferences that medical doctors attend. So we're looking for creative ways to clear the clutter and really inspire them to share the information that they see firsthand at those conferences. And then, of course, we're creating continuing medical education experiences for them, like webinars or videos, so we can make that kind of education available at their time.
It's certainly important to influence the influencers. And I'm curious, are you sensing more interest in beef nutrition?
I say all the time, there's no more exciting time to be in food and nutrition communications than right now. If you're on social media, there's not a day that goes by that you don't see someone share a picture of a smoothie or a dinner they made for their family or a meal they ate at a restaurant. So people are talking about it amongst themselves, and they're looking to experts to help, you know, find out what's the truth about what I'm eating, the truth about where my food comes from, or the science behind a diet or a health tip I should be following. So it's really exciting, but not only is the trend piece of it informing how we shape our programs, we also use consumer research, so market research. And when we survey consumers and ask them, what are the reasons that you'll limit your beef consumption? Five of the top six reasons are health and nutrition reasons. So it is definitely an important piece of what the Checkoff's doing.
Yeah. So speaking of the Checkoff, as we think about other beef producers like myself that pay into this Checkoff, what would you tell us about the kind of returns that this work provides for those of us beef producers?
So I speak from experience when I say that the Live Well program is not new. We do one of these big splashy events every few years because we can ride the wave of the benefits for years to come. It never ceases to amaze me that I'll see a quote in a media story from a dietitian that attended a Live Well either recently or in years past, something that still motivates her to talk about beef favorably. So I know that we're picking the right kind of information to share with them.
Sure.
It also positions both NCBA staff and the Checkoff as a really trusted resource with this really powerful audience. The dividends pay off for years and years to come, and we're excited to build on it, and we create programs that help shape what they learned at the Live Well event into things that we know that they really want to share out with consumers even more.
Fantastic. As we build this cowherd, there's nothing more important than building demand and letting people know that they can eat a delicious product and do it without having any health concerns. Thank
you so
much,
Kevin. Yep.
Still to come on Cattlemen to Cattlemen, we'll take you inside an important study that hopes to unlock the secrets of feed efficiency. Don't go away. We'll be right back.
Want more profit out of your pasture? Then here's our two cents on using parasite control to make some dollars. In a trial of calves, Long Range outperformed Cydectin and Safeguard dewormers combined by as much as an extra 40 pounds. Yeah, that's a lot of extra profit. And that's why it pays to treat cattle with Long Range. Do not treat within 48 days of slaughter. Not for use in female dairy cattle 20 months of age or older, including dry dairy cows or in veal calves. Post-injection site damage can occur. These reactions have disappeared without treatment. You can't afford another season without Long Range.
Well, I think a rancher has to be a steward of the land. There's nobody else that can take care of land better than a rancher. When we switched over to the Purina products, it was a step in the right direction.
The difference we see in the cattle is the consistency of their nutrition.
The cattle hold their condition a lot better throughout the whole year.
It does make a difference that we can see, day in and day out.
You're watching NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen on RFD TV.
Welcome back. It's no secret that a reduction of input costs can have a positive impact on profitability. This is especially true when it comes to feed, one of the biggest expenses for any cattle producer. Reporter Brian Baxter has the latest on an ongoing research project that is working to develop the tools ranchers need to improve feed efficiency in their operations.
Sandhill Farms is a family-owned Hereford seed stock operation located in south central Kansas. The Schultz family has been living on and working this land for the last 150 years, thanks in part to a focus on using the latest technology to help control costs.
It's basically
the same thing as any business. It's doing more with less. It doesn't matter if we're in the livestock producing business or making automobiles. We need to do more with less, and that affects sustainability. That affects our profitability, and if we're not profitable, we can't be sustainable, and the two are glove in hand.
Beef producers understand the value of knowledge and spend lots of time and money evaluating the genetic potential of their cattle. Although research has made it possible to predict a handful of traits, producers want to be able to do the same for something like feed efficiency, which is not easy to see or measure.
You know, beef producers have greatly improved the population for traits like growth and calving ease, and certainly for end product or carcass merit, beef quality, those sort of things. Feed efficiency has largely been unmeasured in the beef industry.
Now that we begin to see a little bit more pressure put on prices, you know, input costs are going to be a huge part of profitability, and we all know that feed costs are one of the big components of that.
One group of researchers is working to expand what we know about feed efficiency. They're part of a USDA-funded project that worked to identify the genetic markers associated with feed intake, and from that information develop selection tools for feed efficiency.
The Feed Efficiency Project has been a five-year, $5 million project funded through a USDA grant. And it's involved nearly 20 scientists at nine different institutions across the United States with the goal of really building the genomic tools to improve feed efficiency in beef cattle here in the U.S.
The goal is to identify the genetic markers associated with feed intake across multiple breeds. Early on, many of the top breed associations recognized how valuable this research could be to their producers.
We were very excited to be a part of the National Feed Efficiency Project, a great collaboration of several breed associations and the top scientists across the U.S. Why it's so important for us to be involved in these projects is we couldn't do them by ourselves, the association independently, and so it's great to get involved in a collaborative effort for such an important trait.
As a breed association, I think it's always important to be able to collaborate with other people in the industry, whether it's other breed associations, certainly academics at the university level, and especially researchers from the U.S. Mark. You know, they're on the very cutting edge of any new technology, and it's vital to be able to interface with those people to stay current in the marketplace.
Phenotypic data had already been collected over the years on thousands of cattle representing multiple breeds. The researchers gathered those existing feed intake and composition records from the breed associations and then collected DNA samples from thousands of new animals.
When we want to build a new genetic evaluation for a novel trait like feed efficiency or feed intake, one of the first things we have to do is go out and gather a lot of phenotypic records. Tens of thousands, potentially, depending on the trait. And our goal in the Feed Efficiency Project was to gather up somewhere between 8,000 and 9,000 individual animal feed intake records, which is a substantial undertaking. So without the collaboration of the breed associations and the producers and the academic institutions that were involved, there's no way we would have been able to gather up an adequate number of phenotypic and genotypic records for this project.
The results of this study have the potential to substantially improve the profitability of beef operations across all levels of the industry.
This project has been essential to the industry to get a repository of feed efficiency phenotypes that go along with genotypes in order for us to develop selection criteria, selection methods for feed efficiency in a multi-breed basis. Something that we can go back to time and again, a true research project that is structured to be useful for the industry for years to come.
I think the Feed Efficiency Project will have a huge impact downstream on the commercial producers by making sure that the seed stock we produce for them is efficient. And that'll have a huge impact on their cow herds eventually as they're starting to keep back progeny out of more efficient animals.
Many cattle producers are taking notice of this study and are beginning to incorporate the technology into their own programs.
We're seeing more and more producers that actually are going to the effort and expense of collecting feed intake on their animals. And again, this project, by sort of illustrating the value of that, has incentivized and motivated some of our breeders that hadn't previously been able or been interested in collecting individual feed intake data to do so.
We've got the opportunity for a smaller breeder that's not normally going to have a contemporary group that he can collect those phenotypes on. He can suddenly demonstrate his feed efficiency prowess, and we can maybe find those exemplary bulls that don't have a large contemporary group that we might not have found otherwise.
The goal of the project was not to completely change the way producers evaluate cattle. Instead, these selection tools provide another useful way to help identify the most profitable and efficient animals.
Genomics are a tool. They're not the ultimate answer in a lot of ways, but they're a tool that we can use. We still need to have the cattleman's knowledge of their business, of their environment, because the environment in western Kansas is different than either one of the coasts. And so we may need to know the genomics, but we still have to be able to apply it to the environment that we are in or our customers are in.
We can't be comfortable with the status quo. We're always looking to add more information and give our members and their customers more useful information to help them select animals that fit their production environment and meet consumer expectations.
We think certainly improvement in feed efficiency improves the profitability options and opportunities for producers in the chain, so animals that go through the feed yard that consume less feed and convert that into pounds of saleable high-quality beef. Makes sense. It does a better job using the resources we're blessed with here in the United States and provides a high quality product for consumers here and around the world.
I'm Brian Baxter reporting for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
To study up on the latest findings, go to the project's website at beefefficiency.org and be sure to keep watching Cattlemen to Cattlemen for regular updates on the project. Still to come, we'll check in with Baxter Black. Plus, see how an Oklahoma cattle operation makes use of John Deere gear to help get their chores done. Stay with us.
Saddle up and make your way to Denver, Colorado for the 2017 Cattle Industry Summer Business Meeting. This is your chance to stay up to date on beef industry trends and policies, meet with industry leadership and your fellow cattlemen and women. Plus, you'll get insights on hot topics at the issues forums. Mark your calendar for the 2017 Cattle Industry Summer Business Meeting, July 12th to the 15th in Denver. Find out more at beefusa.org.
Forward. It's more than a direction. It's mandatory. Because the beef business rewards the progressive, the doers, the ones who know what it takes to go easy on cattle and never set them back. So set your eyes on the horizon. Turn your back to the wind and move your herd the only way you know. Forward. Vista Vaccines. Always ahead.
Welcome back to Cattlemen to Cattlemen. Over the last couple of months, we've seen the devastating damage Mother Nature can do when the weather conditions spark wildfires. And for producers in Oklahoma, the past several years have been an ongoing struggle as drought has been a near constant enemy, reducing forage and hay production. Brian Baxter brings us the story of one Oklahoma veterinarian and cattleman who is doing his best to survive challenging times.
There's no doubt Justin McCrary is one busy guy. He runs his own veterinary hospital, and he tends his own farming and cattle operation in West Central Oklahoma.
I've been a veterinarian for the last 22 years, graduated from vet school in 1995. Shortly thereafter, I took over my uncle's farming and ranching business. It was a small operation, and after his passing, I purchased it from the estate. I have a cow-calf operation, on average about 150 head of cows. I raise some small grains for hay and grazing. I have a little bit of alfalfa. Improved in native grasses for pasture.
As a full-time veterinarian, Justin has watched his fellow cattle producers in Oklahoma endure difficult times the past several years.
Some of the challenges we've had in this area over the past years, we've had some severe drought. We've been drought stricken. A lot of my customers from the veterinary clinic, as well as myself, we had to sell down our cows and our cow numbers. We're working on rebuilding those numbers back to where we were prior and where we want to be in the future.
In fact, in much of the southern plains, getting any kind of forage or hay put up these past few years has been a challenge.
So during those drought years, hay quality was average at best, and quantity was below normal. So we struggled to find a good source of nutrition for our cows that we had remaining. Selling down those numbers and keeping the pastures stocked appropriately for drought conditions helped us get through those times without having the extra amount of hay that we really needed.
Even with these challenges, Justin, like so many of his fellow cattle producers, is committed to staying in the business and working with the best equipment to put up all the hay they can.
I could probably buy hay cheaper, but I don't know what the TDN, what the protein levels of those hay are going to be. I'd rather have my own equipment, manage my forage the way I want it managed, and put up the hay that I want to put up in the times that it needs to be put up. My John Deere equipment has been there for me. I'm a busy, busy person. At the end of the day, I want to be able to get in my piece of equipment, whether it's a windrower or a tractor or a skid loader, and I want to have it there so I can rely on it.
When it comes to equipment you can rely on, Justin found a winner in his John Deere tractor.
I've got a 6140R tractor, just perfect size and horsepower for my mid-size operation. I use it for raking hay, baling hay, do some dirt work with it. A lot of stacking and hauling hay. We use that tractor to load and haul hay with. It's a very comfortable tractor to use. At the end of the day, after a long day at the vet clinic, it's nice to get into a piece of equipment that rides smooth, it's comfortable. It's like driving a vehicle rather than a tractor. And that's very important to me, especially if I'm gonna have a long evening on a tractor in the hay field. The field cruise option on that tractor is excellent. You don't have to adjust your RPMs to match your baling speed. Set the RPM to where you want it, and go. It stays at that RPM no matter what kind of windrows you're in, heavy hay, light hay. Excellent fuel saver to have that field cruise option.
Another outstanding feature on this tractor is called the JD Link.
JD Link, or John Deere Link, is a great communication tool from the tractor to the dealer to myself. We can look at that information, and we can look at fuel usage, codes that the computer might be throwing. We can also locate that tractor if it's been stolen, which my tractor and baler were stolen, and we use JD Link to recover that tractor and baler. We found it over 50 miles away from where it was at when I left it. We found that tractor in less than 30 minutes.
And as is true for cattle producers who are growing their own hay, when it's time to be in the field, they need to know they can count on their John Deere dealer to be there with whatever they need.
The service side of it, we're always there. We can bring your parts, bring your wrap. We actually have a 569 of our own that we run, so I'm very familiar with it. Guys can call me with questions, and I can usually walk them through it. And if I can't, we've got an excellent hay man at Weatherford that will sure get them up and running.
Western Equipment's been there for me through some tough times and some really good times. Whether I need service, parts, if I need to talk to a sales guy, one phone call, even after hours, I can get a hold of my salesman after hours, and they've been really good to me, always there for me.
They know they can call me anytime, day or night. I've always answered the phone and walk them through it or help them out and get them back going. More than one occasion, I've took parts out of my own operation to get somebody going in the middle of the night that was broke down trying to beat a rain. And we do what we have to do to get them going.
In Oklahoma, I'm Brian Baxter reporting for NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen.
If you'd like to learn more about the full line of John Deere tractors and hay equipment, head to your local John Deere dealer or visit the website johndeere.com. When we return, we'll check in with Baxter Black. Stay with us.
You know, there is a saying, hay lost in the field robs yield. That's why John Deere balers are designed with tightly spaced belts so you capture more crop in every pass. Compared to other balers with wide spaced belt designs, John Deere balers let you put up more quality hay and put more money in your pocket. That's how we run.
That's why nothing runs like a deer.
Blaze a trail to Phoenix, Arizona and the 2018 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show. It's the cattle industry's biggest convention with education, networking, and fun. Plus, you can check out the huge NCBA Trade Show, outstanding entertainment, and more. Don't miss the 2018 Cattle Industry Convention and NCBA Trade Show in Phoenix, January 31st through February 2nd. Visit beefusa.org for more.
We know you're up before the dawn because the cattle rise before the sun. And you spend long hours in the saddle because the herd isn't always over the next rise. And you care for the land because you know it takes care of your family. And we know you do great work. And it's time to tell that story to the marketplace. IMI Global is here to help you do just that. When a new calf hits the ground, his clock starts ticking. A belly full of colostrum gives him his best odds, but if he doesn't get any, his time starts running out. That's when you grab a bag of Oxford Ag Colostrum in their patented feeding system. Fill them with warm water, shake it to mix, feed it with a tube or nipple, and you are done. No bucket, no bottle, no mess, and right on time. Get yours at OxfordAg.com. Costs less than a dead calf.
Now I've listened to you varmints bragging about cowboys, the toughest you've known. But the first liar don't have a chance, boys, because I knew one tough to the bone. He come out from someplace in Kansas, and in truth he was hard to dislike because he weren't really mean, just hard-headed. We called him P. Williker Mike. When the weather got down below freezing, well, he'd never cover his ears, so now each one looks like a knot hole because the pieces broke off through the years. And a she-bear invaded his camp once, insisted on sharing his plate, but he saved the last of his biscuit, though now he can just count to eight. And he used to have both of his elbows and a forehead without so much slope till a cow jerked him out of the saddle and he wouldn't let go of the rope. Well, he's faster than most fixing fences, though it's almost beyond belief because he keeps both hands free for pounding by stretching the wire with his teeth. And what's more, he don't use a hammer. Drives nails with the back of his hand. This last thing I'm fixing to tell you will prove that there's no tougher man. While bringing a cow to the home ranch, adrift in a cowboy's dreams, a rattlesnake up and surprised him. And his horse come apart at the seams. He bucked clean out of the saddle so high that his bad breath condensed and he come down a cussin' and lighted a straddle a dadgum barbed wire fence. Cut him right up to the buckle between his feet and his chin. Hey, he just let his stirrups out longer and rode his old pony on in. This is Baxter Black from out there.
Thanks, Baxter. We sure appreciate your contributions to our show each and every week. We'll have more Cattlemen to Cattlemen right after this. Stay with us.
Say goodbye to your toughest pasture and rangeland weeds for good. Because one product offers season-long control, handles the widest spectrum of broadleaf weeds, and clears the way for increased forage with greater grazing flexibility. So you get more beef per acre at a cost that can't be beat. It's Grazon Next HL herbicide. And if it's in your pastures, plain and simple, weeds won't be.
I'm an NCBA member because NCBA, they look at the facts, they look at the history, and they look what's good for the industry.
It's important to be NCBA members just because of what NCBA does. They keep us informed about a lot of things that are going on nationwide.
The reason we're an NCBA member is we think that it's the best voice that the cattle people have.
Join NCBA today. Head to beefusa.org or call 866-USA-BEEF.
Welcome back. There are many great reasons to become a member of NCBA, and one of them is the chance to read the National Cattlemen. It's the official publication of NCBA, and it provides timely news and articles about the issues and events affecting the beef industry. A subscription is included free of charge when you become an NCBA member. Joining is easy. Just give us a call at 1-866-USA-BEEF or visit us online at beefusa.org. It's time once again for legacy photos. Let's check out some of the great shots from farms and ranches all around our country. Would you like to see your photo on Cattlemen to Cattlemen? You can submit your favorite shots at our website, cattlementocattlemen.org. Be sure to include your ranch, your farm name, and hometown, and we may use them on a future episode. Well, that's our time for this week's edition of NCBA's Cattlemen to Cattlemen. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you again next week right here on RFD TV.